سلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وابتغوا إليه الوسيلة وجاهدوا في سبيله لعلكم تفلحون. صدق الله العظيم، وبلغنا رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. So before we move on to the completion of the ruku, this one ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded the people of Iman to fear Allah and search for a wasila, search for their wasila to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have explained that wasila is a station or nearness by the way of love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's one discussion that Hazrat Mufassireen have made, which should be pointed out here, which should be mentioned, is that after azan, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has asked all his followers to make a special dua for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that in that dua we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant the station of wasila to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this wasila, Hazrat Mufassireen have said that this wasila is a station of perfect nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this world, everyone has their own level of nearness and connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we learn from the meanings of the Quran and the Hadith that the more people work in this world on their nearness and connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, respective to that, their station will be in the Jannah. So those people, the commoners, they will get in Jannah by special mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the nearness that is the level of ulama and arifin in this world. The people who have worked on their connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who really recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ulama and arifin, their station will be achieved by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by even the commoners. The ulama and arifin will gain the station of nearness that is comparable to the station of nearness and recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has been achieved by the anbiya in this world, the common anbiya, all anbiya apart from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The anbiya will gain the nearness that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had in this world. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be given the station of perfect wasila, perfect nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is also the one of the explanations, one of the explanations that ulama say that this might be the maqam of Mahmud, the maqam Mahmud, the praiseworthy station that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has asked his ummah to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for him. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says wabtaghu ilayhi alwasila, herein is meaning that while you are alive, work hard on your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Based on that connection will be your station in Jannah. If you are very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will be increased multiple folds in the Jannah. If you are not so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and still you enter Jannah, then your station will not be as high as the Anbiya in terms of nearness, but it will be like the ulama and arifin of this world. And not only try to search for this wasila, but work hard on this wasila. Wajahidu fi sabili, some Fasirin have said that wajahidu fi sabili would mean that work hard on sabili would refer to wasila, that ibtigha of wasila. Sabili would refer to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by working hard on obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gain nearness. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ, so that if you work hard on this connection, then you will be successful. We'll try to complete there's three more ayat in this ruku'. The meaning and the ma'arif and the masail are long, but we'll do the basic translation and the history behind it, inshallah, and then next week we'll do the ma'arif and masail. يا أيها الذين يا أيها الرسول لا يحزنك الذين يسارعون في الكفر من الذين قالوا آمنا بأفواههم ولم تؤمن قلوبهم ومن الذين هادوا سماعون للكذب سماعون لقوم آخرين لم يأتوك يحرفون الكلمة من بعد مواضعه يقولون إن أوتيتم هذا فخذوه وإن لم تؤتوه فاحذروا وَمَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ فِتْنَتَهُ فَلَنْ تَمْلِكَ لَهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا أُولَئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَمْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ أَنْ يُطَهِّرَ قُلُوبَهُمْ لَهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا خِزْيٌ وَلَهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ سَمَّاعُونَ لِلْكَذِبِ أَكَّالُونَ لِلسُّحْتِ فَإِنْ جَاءُوكَ فَاحْكُم بَيْنَهُمْ أَوْ أَعْرِضْ عَنْهُمْ وَإِنْ تُعْرِضْ عَنْهُمْ فَلَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ شَيْئًا وَإِنْ حَكَمْتَ فَاحْكُم بَيْنَهُمْ بِالْقِسْطِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ وكيف يحكمونك وعندهم التوراة فيها حكم الله ثم يتولون من بعد ذلك وما أولئك بالمؤمنين. So these ayat refer to two specific happenings in history. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he came to Medina, there was Jewish people there. There was Ansar and there was Jewish people. And in the Jewish people, there was two tribes primarily, Banu Nudayr and Banu Qurayza. Banu Nudayr were the stronger ones, and Banu Nudayr were the more respectable ones, and Banu Qurayza were always their kind of subordinates. So Torah, although established equality between human beings and they belong to the same religion, but still, because Banu Qurayza were stronger and because they were more respectable in society, they overpowered the Banu Nudayr, overpowered the Banu Qurayza. And so much so that they agreed to a humiliating pact for Banu Qurayza, which was that when qisas would be taken, when a person of Banu Qurayza would kill a person of Banu Nudayr, the qisas would be not by a human life. So Banu Qurayza will not be able to kill a person of Banu Nudayr in return, but they will only give them some certain amount of dates. And if a person of Banu Qurayza was killed, the inferior tribe, then the superior tribe will not give them any life in return, but they will just give them dates. And if a person of Banu Nuzayr, the higher tribe, was killed by a person of the lower tribe, then full qisas, not only full qisas, but double the qisas would be taken. So if a man was killed, if a woman was killed, a man would be killed. A slave was killed, a free man will be killed in return. And similarly, not only there will be qisas in terms of life, but also there will be diyat, which is that they will also give that amount of dates in addition to that life. And not only that amount of dates, but double the amount of dates. And similar were their laws. So a lot of disparity. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, they made a pact of peace. These people did not become a dhimmi. These people did not become the people of kind, which are protected and under the cover, under the shade of Muslim government. But they just made a pact of peace. So whenever there something arose, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they could bring their trials to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not. It was up to them. If they were zimmi, had they been zimmi, then it was necessary for them to bring all their decisions to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So one such thing happened, that a person of Banu Qurayza, the inferior tribe, killed the Banu Nudayr, one of the Banu Nudayr. Now the Banu Nudayr asked for their, according to that pact, they wanted to get a life and certain amount of dates and all that. So the Banu Qurayza had known that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is here and he is in power here. So they suggested, they said that we are the same religion and we don't agree to that pact anymore. Since we are the same religion, the same people, the same, essentially the same people, we live in the same area, we will not give in to this. And they started fighting. And it went to such an extent that a war could have erupted between them. So someone suggested that go to this man of Arabia, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who has come from Makkah, and get your issue settled. Now the Banu Qurayza and Banu Nudayr both were Jewish. And Jewish people, they sent some spies ahead of time. So the criminals did not come themselves, but they sent some spies. The Banu Nudayr were the criminals in this case. They sent some spies and asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tried to get a know-how and insight of what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to decide. And they had said that if you find out that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to decide in favor, then accept it. And if he's going to decide based on equality, then we'll not accept it. So this is one of the happenings that happened. The other story is that among these Yahud, there occurred a zina. And the punishment of zina, they basically came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to ask for the punishment. When they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam first got an affirmation for them, asked them for an affirmation that whatever I decide, are you going to agree to it? They said that we are going to agree to it. When they had agreed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down Jibreel, and the command came that since these people are not unmarried, they are already married, both of them, their punishment is that both will be stoned to death. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them this decision, they wanted to run away. They became surprised by this decision. Then Jibreel alayhi salam told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that there is a person, ask them to bring that person, his name is Ibn Surya. Tell him the features of Ibn Surya and ask them what do they think about him. And when they say good things about him, ask them to make him a hakam, somebody who is going to decide. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked them that, do you know about a young man who's fair complexion but he's deprived of one eye, and what do you think about that man? They said, yes, his name is Ibn Surya, and he's the best alim of Torah among us. Prophet ﷺ said, call him and he can decide between you. Come, bring him here and make him a hakam. So he was called, and the Prophet ﷺ then gave him the oath, the qasam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically. So when the Prophet ﷺ gave him the qasam, he became afraid. And he said that the oath, the swearing of the one whom you claim has sent you as a Nabi and the one who has sent down Torah, I say that in Torah also the punishment for zina after marriage is stoning to death. The Prophet ﷺ asked him that, what has come over you people that you are so knowledgeable and you claim you make tall claims of following the Torah, then why do you not obey that punishment? So he said that it is a problem with this Yahud, us Yahud, that we have the severe punishments that were given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we've toned them down. So it so happened that there was a prince among us who committed zina and we did not execute this punishment of stoning to death upon him. Then someone inferior did it and we wanted to execute this punishment, but the people said that this cannot happen, first kill that prince as well. So we reduced the punishment for everyone and we reduced it to some beating, some whiplashes, and blackening the face and putting him in a donkey and making him go rounds in the city. So their falsehood was made apparent before everyone. These are the background of this ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that do not worry about these people. These people are going to keep coming, they try to spy and they run towards kufr from iman, although they know what is the right path, they know what is in Torah. This has become apparent before everyone that their alim is saying and you are telling something that is in their book as well, and you are telling them about some person that you did not know before. All of this has come as a clear sign to them, but these people run to kufr and they want to spy on you. So don't worry about them, they have chosen kufr for themselves. When somebody has chosen kufr for themselves, then Allah also decides kufr for them. When they have made firm resolve of kufr, then Allah is also going to decide kufr for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explained this, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us some masail in these ayat. Inshallah, we'll do them next week. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, As-salatu was-salamu ala Sayyidul Mursaleen. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna minal khasirin. Rabbi ighfir warham wa anta khayrul rahimin. Sallallahu ta'ala ala khayri khalqih Sayyidina wa maulana Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amin. Bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.